Welcome, everybody. My name is Mina Jane, and I'm the director of the Ashland Public Library. I am here with one of our favorite speakers, Sarah Robertson-Barnes, talking about how to prevent food waste, something that's really close to our hearts. But if you've ever been here with us before with Sarah, you know she'll have lots of tips and tricks for you to be the best sustainability warrior you can be. So, before we get started, I just want to say a couple things. Thanks to the Friends of the Ashland Public Library who support all of our programs, as well as Sarah for letting us share this program with other libraries. As I said a couple minutes, just a minute ago, over 40 libraries signed up to partner with us on this one. So, obviously, we love Sarah. So, we are being recorded. I'll send out the recording link after the program. I will turn the chat off during Sarah's presentation, so there's no distractions. You can still chat with me, but just not with each other. And I'll turn it back on after the presentation. And if you have questions, just put them in the Q&A, which is at the bottom, a button at the bottom of your screen. Sarah, welcome back. You, I know, sustainable in the suburbs, wonderful. Or I watch you on Instagram all the time, and I'm just like, how does she come up with all of this? So welcome back.
Hi, thank you so much for having me again, and I'm very excited to talk about food waste tonight. All right, so we're ready, Mina? Here we go. So as Mina just said, I'm Sarah, and my blog is called Sustainable in the Suburbs. And we are not moving here. Sorry, just a moment. My slides are not. There we go. Oh dear.
Yep, no, we're good.
Okay, we're moving now. We have a little bit of an internet lag here tonight. So I'm a sustainable living expert. I'm just your average suburban soccer mom trying to do the thing in areas that maybe lack the infrastructure, but just doing the best that I can because there's no such thing as a perfect environmentalist. Just a little bit about my family. So these are my two little guys. They are tweens now. But we've been doing this their whole lives. So we're a plant-based family. I started looking into the effects of plastic when we were experiencing infertility and pregnancy loss, and it just sort of became my raison d'être since then. We do minimalist and all that kind of stuff. But I found the zero waste hashtag on social media about 8 years ago, and that's when this really became my mission and my purpose. So I don't love the term zero waste, actually. I've moved away from that because it's just impossible. Our infrastructure is not set up for it. So instead, I like to talk about a sustainable lifestyle. And what that really means for me is shifting my mindset away from single use and disposability, even recycling, focusing on that reduce, reuse part first. And chances are you probably have everything that you need to get started at home. So let's talk about that a little bit. But first, I just want to congratulate you for things that you are probably already doing. When things become habit, we don't think about them anymore. So I do want us to just give ourselves a pat on the back for some eco things that we're already doing. It's very much second nature to just bring our own bags now. These plastic bag bans have had such a great effect, and folks are already doing that. So congrats, as well as your reusable water bottle. And of course, most of us are doing recycling and composting. If you have a municipal pickup program, then you're probably already composting. And we'll talk a little bit more about home composting later. So if you're already doing these things, you are doing amazing. So we know the three R's are reduce, reuse, recycle. I think we tend to focus on recycling a lot. We need to get better about the reduce, and I'll give you some tricks for reusing. The first R that I like to really focus on is refusing. And so, what that means is just refusing the things that we do not need. So, getting really comfortable with saying, nope, don't need that. I actually don't need to order that thing from Amazon. Maybe I can wait 30 days, that sort of thing. And the bottom one here, rot, is what we're going to be talking about today. And the reason that I want to talk about food waste, and I want to talk about food waste to everyone all the time, all day long, is that nothing breaks down in a landfill, not even food. And we'll talk about why in a moment. So, why does preventing food waste matter? The first one is in this economy, groceries are so expensive, especially here in Canada where we have a grocery monopoly situation going on. Groceries are so expensive right now. And when we waste food, I love this quote from Dana Gunders. Imagine walking out of the grocery store with four bags of groceries, dropping one in the parking lot, and just not bothering to pick it up. That's essentially what we're doing. And if food waste was a country, it would be the third largest emitter of greenhouse gases, in particular methane. And we'll talk about that a little bit later as well. So, both for the impact on our wallets and on the planet, we really need to get serious about reducing and, in some cases, even eliminating our food waste on a household level. Okay. So I had to look up some US stats for this. It is a big problem in Canada as well, but I found some US stats for you folks. How big is the problem? Well, we are throwing out from our food supply anywhere between 120 and 126 billion pounds of food per year. So the US wastes more food than any other country in the world. It is about 40% of the food supply. Now, about half of this happens at the production level. So that's things just rotting in the fields or in transport, and then behind the scenes at retailers where it's just thrown out for whatever reason. That's about $218 to $444 billion per year of food loss. And that takes up 22% of space in landfills. And if none of it's breaking down, that's a lot of space in your municipal landfill that is absolutely preventable. Now, at the household level, these are Canadian stats that I got from Love Food Hate Waste. So times it by 10. You folks are about 10 times our population. So on average, the average Canadian family is throwing away $1,300 of food per household. And 63% of that was food that could have already been used in some way. And most of that's vegetables. And I know in my house, most of that ends up being the box of spinach that you think you're going to eat the day that you buy it, and then it goes bad. And we'll talk about why that happens as well. But as you can see from this chart here, the vast majority of it is produce that ends up getting thrown out. Okay. So, we're going to take a three-prong approach to avoiding food waste. We're going to start at the store, and then how you store it, and then what to do with food that simply cannot be eaten. So, we're going to talk about purchasing, storage, compost, and other ways you can reuse food, which is a thing. Okay. So, we'll start with purchasing. This is the less fun part, unless you like spreadsheets and that sort of thing. It's not my jam, but this is what my husband takes care of. The first thing that I recommend doing is to do a pantry audit. So this means taking everything out, all of your dry goods, take it all out of the cupboards, give the cupboard a nice little wipe down, make note of what you already have. So like make a physical list of everything that you already have, and you are going to find stuff that you forgot was in there, and clear out what you can't use. So anything that's expired or you're just simply not going to get through, clear that out. And now you have a good idea of what you actually have and then what you actually need to buy. Going forward, you're going to have that list on your phone of what you've already got on hand and then what needs to be replaced so that you aren't overbuying and losing things at the back of the cupboard. Along those lines, we're also going to clean out the fridge. It's not my favorite chore either, but again, there is stuff in there that is a science project at this point. So we're going to get rid of that. We're going to get rid of what's expired to start fresh. And that's also going to make it easier for you to reorganize your fridge to store things properly. And I'm going to talk about that in a second. But most of us are not using our fridges correctly. They're either too cold or too warm, or things aren't in the box where they're supposed to be. And that's causing food spoilage to speed up a little bit. So I'm going to show you where to put things in your fridge to keep them fresh longer. And the last one that I hate doing, but I do it and I promise it makes a difference, is to start meal planning. And it doesn't have to be breakfast, lunch, and dinner. We generally go for 4 to 5 dinners that we know we're going to make during the week. And then we just get our usual staples, and that pretty much covers us for breakfast, lunch, and leftovers for the week so that we aren't over purchasing or also having to run out to the store and get random ingredients for things. And then, of course, they go bad or we waste money on them and so on. Okay. And I also have some tips for how to shop to avoid food waste. So the first one is to shop package free. Now, I know this is really not possible a lot of the time, that a lot of things come pre-packaged at our grocery stores, and there isn't a lot that you can do about that. But when you can avoid it, avoid it. And so, as you can see in my little picture here, this is me getting loose green beans at my local farm boy in a reusable produce bag. Those plastic produce bags, not only are they like single use and you just basically throw them out when you get home, or you store your food in them in the fridge, and that causes them to spoil even faster because the food can't breathe. So if you can refill in your own containers, such as the produce bag, or choose loose produce, nothing bad's going to happen if you just put, the bananas on the conveyor belt. Like, you're going to wash your food when you get home anyway. So anytime that you can avoid that plastic that chokes your food, do that. Choose info. So a lot of the times the weird looking fruit doesn't even make it out onto the floor of the grocery store. It just gets tossed because it looks weird, and consumers want that perfect apple, that perfect tomato. So if you can start showing your retailer, and feel free to talk to the produce manager, I've done that, put out the imperfect food, get that lonely banana, because it's just going to end up getting tossed in the bin behind the store. The stores are not composting. Check out the reduced produce section. That's in my Instagram stories today. I go there first, the reduced section of our produce. It's all wrapped in plastic, which sucks, but avoiding food waste is more important than avoiding plastic wherever possible. So I bought 4 pounds of organic bananas for like $2, and they just went straight into the freezer. So check for that first, because I'm keeping it in use and out of the landfill. Choose the weird looking carrots, get the funky looking potatoes. We know that it's perfectly good food, but most people are going to pass that by, and it's going to end up in landfill. And then the last one, if you have access to a farmer's market or just straight up a farm, buy the produce when it's local and in season. It's a great way to get a huge flat of strawberries rather than those little clamshells all winter, and just throw them in the freezer if you have the space. So those are some of the ways that we can shop to avoid food waste at the source or at the retailer. Okay. And there are lots of ways to store your food without plastic as well. Not just to avoid the waste, but food can't breathe when it's in plastic, and it will in fact spoil faster. So the example that I gave of the sort of rotting spinach soup in the clamshell, once I stopped storing it in there, then it lasted longer, and I have spent less money throwing spinach directly into the trash. Use glass. So jars, it doesn't have to look pretty. It can just be reused pickle jars. I've got lots of those too. Those are great for storing your leftovers. We have a few glass Tupperware as well. You can freeze in glass, I promise. As long as it's just a little bit below the shoulder, then it should be fine. It does take a little bit more to come up to room temperature, but it is absolutely possible. That being said, if you have lots of plastic Tupperware, that's fine. Use that. But if you can switch over to glass wherever possible, that's going to keep your food fresher a little bit longer. The next one, counterintuitive, but just keep it loose. A lot of things can be left as is, stored in an open bowl or a basket. I just have a basket in the crisper in my fridge, and I just chuck the peppers and things like that in there. They don't need to be in anything. They're fine in the fridge. You're going to use them in a few days anyway. And this one I really can't stress enough, is to use cloth to wrap things. So with my spinach example, I take it out of the clamshell when I have to buy it like that during the winter, and I wrap it in a damp tea towel, and that keeps it fresh for well over a week. You can also get cloth bags that you can keep things in. You can keep it right in the produce bag. I've got a broccoli crown right now that I'm going to be using tomorrow that's just in the cloth bag. I just chucked it in the fridge. And then wax wraps. I'm sure you've seen them, the beeswax wraps. instead of saran wrap, and your food can still breathe in those. So your avocado will last, half an avocado will last for days in the fridge when it's wrapped in a beeswax wrap. So they're really simple, but really brilliant ways to store food. That being said, I could talk about how to store every sort of fruit and vegetable there is, and that could be a whole separate talk. But all this information, I'm going to send out an email after this in about a week or so with some resources for you. So I mentioned earlier about where to store food in your fridge. And I converted this to Fahrenheit. So here we keep it set to about 4 degrees Celsius. For you folks, that's going to be between 37 and 40, depending on the ambient temperature of your kitchen. And the middle shelf is the most consistent temperature. So that's where you need to be keeping things that will spoil. So that's where you're going to want to keep your dairy, especially your milk. I was keeping our milk in the door of the fridge, and it was going off if the kids weren't getting through it. Now that I store it in the middle of the fridge, it lasts so much longer. And that's where we store the extras as well, as on that middle shelf in the fridge. On our upper shelves is where I keep what I call our cut plate. So I've got an onion that's cut in half, an apple that's cut in half, whatever, and it just goes cut side down, just on the plate. I don't wrap it in anything. That's the eat me first area. It's right at eye level. So I can see, like, oh, yep, I cut into an onion yesterday. I still have one. Oh, this needs to get eaten for leftovers. Send that for school lunch. Whatever it is, it's right at your eye level. That needs to go first. And then, of course, your crispers need to be set for humidity. You don't have to change that up too much. But anything that is processed or has a more shelf-stable life, that can go in the door. So that's your condiments and your prepared beverages and things like that. But that eye level section is really, really key for avoiding things getting lost in your fridge or forgetting that you have them. So earlier I talked about how nothing breaks down in a landfill, not even food. So we have it in our heads that, like, oh, it's biodegradable, so it's fine. But it's not biodegrading because that is not a natural environment. Food cannot and will not break down properly in a landfill. And the reason for that is that everything gets very, it's in a plastic bag, first of all, if you're throwing it out with your kitchen trash. It's in a plastic bag, so it can't breathe. And then it gets compressed down. And rather than breaking down naturally the way that it would out in your garden, say, it starts to release methane gas, which is a significant contributor to greenhouse gas emissions. So food waste releases methane gas, and in the US, that's the equivalent of almost 33 million cars worth of gas or worth of methane per year. That's very significant, and most of it is avoidable. So what can we do? Reuse your food. I just spoke with Mina before this about getting this cookbook. This is from the Zero Waste Chef, Anne Marie Bonneau, and it's full of recipes for how to reuse your food. She's amazing, and I recommend taking this book out of the library and just having a flip through to see all of the amazing ways that you can reuse food. And another great channel to follow online is Max Lamanna, and he's a zero waste chef as well. Some of the things that I do in my own kitchen, you can see here, are making veggie broth from scraps. I'm sure most of our grandmothers did it. You might be doing it right now. That stuff is liquid gold. I do it all the time. I use it in everything. You can make pesto out of pretty much anything, carrot tops, broccoli stems. Whatever you've got, you can make pesto out of it. Soups, smoothies, of course, is where all of our weird looking fruit things go. And so the muffin you can see me holding is secret pumpkin and zucchini. I make dog treats out of weird looking yams and things like that. We make popsicles, or I'll dehydrate it and I'll turn it into a powder that I can then just scoop into spaghetti sauce or whatever. So I have pea powder and I have carrot powder and mushroom powder and all these different things that I dehydrate and then throw into whatever I'm cooking. Okay. And then, of course, composting. I'm a huge compost nerd. And again, I could give a whole talk on each of these different types of composting. This is our backyard bin. We also have municipal pickup, so we can put our green bin out with our recycling every week. And I do take advantage of that in the winter. And then for things that just won't break down fast enough in my backyard bin. So things like avocado pits and things like that. But we just have this big bin that we got from our town, actually. So take a look with your municipality, especially right now during Earth Month. But as we get into garden season, our municipality has a big sale on compost bins and also rain barrels. And so I got our backyard bins from them. I think it was like $20. So it's a great deal. And we just take our food scraps out there as well as our compost brown, so cardboard and paper and toilet paper rolls and things like that. And that's my son out there turning the compost right now. And then we use it in our garden. If you have a smaller space backyard, you can get a tumbler. It's about this big and it sits on a rack and you turn it this way. And it has two sides. That's a really great for a small space in a backyard to take your food scraps out to. The other option, which weirds some people out and it weirded me out, but now I'm a proud worm farmer. I have a vermicomposting bin in my kitchen and I use that in the winter as well. And it's exactly what it sounds like. You've got worms in it, and it's a cute little bin. It looks like a stool in my kitchen. You wouldn't know that it's, that it's worms that I feed vegetable scraps and shredded paper to. And then you get worm castings from them, which is really great fertilizer for your household plants. And the last one, there's lots of other methods. There's fermenting methods and underground methods and that sort of thing. But the last one that's useful for regular folks would be the countertop machines. So they're called loamy. There's a couple different brands now, and you just throw your stuff in it, turn it on, and in 2 or 3 hours, you have some very dry soil at the end that you can then just toss outside or use in your house plants or what have you. If you don't have space or are not inclined to do any of these things, there are other options. A friend of mine who lives in a condo, so in a vertical living, you may not have access to a green bin because your building doesn't pay for it. So she fully just went across the street to a single family detached home and knocked on their door and asked, like, can I put my stuff in your green bin every week? Sure, yeah, no problem. And also a lot of farmers markets will have a community drop-off location. So you can bring your compost to the farmers market in the summer as well. Okay, I just really blazed through that. But again, I'm happy to answer any question about composting or whatever. This is a quote from Anne Marie Bonneau, the Zero Waste Chef. And it's my favorite one. I think about it every day that we don't need just a handful of people doing zero waste perfectly. We need millions of people doing it imperfectly. Just do what you can, and if you can't do the thing, that's fine. Just you can do something else. We need everybody doing the thing that they're good at. Everybody doing their little bit will really move the needle. So be imperfect. Okay, and this is where you can find me. If you have any other questions or you want to send me an email or whatever, you can slide into my DMs. That's my website, Sustainable in the Suburbs, and you can find me mostly on Instagram, just at my name, at Sarah Robertson-Barnes.
Awesome. Thank you, Sarah.
Okay. Question time. That's my compost bowl. Yeah.
I know the very first time we talked, you talked about the worm farm, and I was like, I have got to see this, and I still have not. So I'm
Yeah.
it's on my bucket list of things to do and see
Oh,
in my house.
okay. Yeah.
Okay, so we do have questions.
Yeah.
For everybody who's here, put them in the Q&A, which so I can keep a track of them, because otherwise I lose track. And there was a couple of comments in the chat that I thought were interesting. So now that I've reopened the chat to everyone, please feel
Sure.
free to repost them. Jane asks, what app do you use to keep track of pantry and refrigerator food?
I just use notes, not notes, Google Keep, same difference. So my husband and I, we use Google Keep for the family. So we have our grocery list, and then whenever we each think of something, we just add it. And then we have same thing for what's in the pantry and what's in the fridge. We keep that there as well. And then before I go to the grocery store, I do that on Thursday mornings. I just double check. That way I'm not standing there like, oh God, what do we have? What are we going to eat? It's made a big difference. I'm such a scatterbrain that having he made the list, I'll be perfectly honest, that's what he's good at. So he made the list, and then it just simply becomes once you start adding the items, you can check them and uncheck them so you don't have to input them each time.
So that's like a
So
shared
that's
Google app, right? That's a shared Google app, right?
just Google Keep. You could do the same thing with notes if you have an iPhone. And then one of the resources that I'll have for the attendees a little bit later is I have a printable as well. So what's in my pantry? What's in my fridge? What do I need? And that can help you organize it in the way that works best for your brain and your family.
Do you think that a lot of people have those see-through fridges now? Is that something that's helpful, or like the front is glass? I
With
would
the
never do that.
window.
My refrigerator's a mess, but some people like that.
I don't love that. I haven't heard of that. I mean, I guess you can see what's inside without having to open the door, which is good because then it's not losing coolant, but I don't know if that would be helpful for me. But maybe I haven't actually seen one, so I'm not sure. But yeah, when we're standing there with the doors wide open, wondering what's in the fridge, like that's not great either because you're introducing warm air into your fridge. So if you have a general idea of what's in there, yeah.
Jennifer asks, what are your thoughts and opinions and insight regarding the electric shelf top composter or dehydrators?
Oh, so yeah, I did mention the loamy. So again, up at our cottage, we can't compost because of bears. We thought about getting a countertop composter for there, but they are very expensive. I will say that. They are very expensive. They're coming down in price, but they are pretty expensive. So instead, we just put it in a bag and bring it home. If it's something that you're interested in doing and it's in your budget, then I would say go for it. It might be great if you're in a vertical living situation, like I mentioned, being in a condo. But for me, like just living in a regular residential neighborhood, I do have different options. So it's not something that I personally have. Yeah, it's one of those like if it works for you, great, but I wouldn't necessarily recommend buying one. I don't think it's a must-have.
I don't know if people know this, but sometimes you can get a dehydrator from your local library in their library of things. I know the Dovertown Library has a dehydrator in their collection.
And that's a bit different than the countertop composter. So I do have a food dehydrator. I bought it secondhand through Facebook Marketplace, and it's like a prepper one, like a doomsday prepper one. It's huge, and I love it. Precisely because then I can go and buy like the bag of weird apples and make a ton of apple chips, or I'll get like the from the reduced section, I can get berries or whatever. And just throw them in the dehydrator and make them into powder. I do it with my herbs. I just did it with a bunch of weird carrots I had in my fridge this week, just to make into powder for sauces and that. And I love it. I really do love it.
Kathy asked the same question about can you please tell us a little bit more about dehydrating to make vegetable powder? Why would you do this? What would you use it for? Do you use it to keep things from going bad?
Yeah, so I just mentioned that we had some carrots in the fridge that were starting to. I wasn't sure how long they'd been in there, frankly. And so I thought, well, I think it was like 4 or 5 jumbo carrots. And I thought, okay, well, I'll just peel them and slice them on the mandolin and put them in the dehydrator, fired them through the blender. And now I have a little jar of carrot powder that I just chuck a spoonful in my smoothie, or I'll put a spoonful in soup that I'm making, or in pasta sauce, or whatever. That way they're not going to landfill. They could go into my compost bin, sure, but I thought, well, they still like look okay, so can I eat them? I go to reuse before rot, so well, can I still actually eat these somehow? And some days I'm just like, I can't, no, they're going in the compost bin, and that's fine too because I'm making soil. So yeah, it's just sort of what do you have the capacity to do at this time.
No, that makes sense. A couple people have mentioned in our area, Black Earth Compost. Sally mentions it, that is a subscription curbside composting service, which I had not known about. There is a fee, but as Sarah mentioned, you can coordinate with your neighbors if you'd like to do that. So if you're not going to do it, by yourself or, in your backyard, you can do it with this service.
Yeah, that's
Lynn,
awesome.
yeah. I mean, we're working on it, we're thinking about it, but we're just not at the level we need to be. Linda asked, did you say that beeswax cloth is better than plain cloth? And where do you get beeswax cloth?
Oh, okay. So I use them for separate things. So a beeswax wrap, it is that's been coated beeswax or soy wax. There are different formulas. You can typically get those at like sort of like your local general store, like those stores that have like cute cards and little eco things, and you can buy them online. There's lots of different retailers that sell them. There's a great company called Abego, Abeego. They're a Canadian company. They're probably the most well-known wax wrap. They last forever. They come in different sizes from small to big, like for wrapping up a loaf of bread. So you would use that in the place of saran wrap, where you're used to using cling wrap. You would use that. You can also use it to cover a bowl. You can use them to open jars because it gives you a good grip. You can fold it into a funnel. They're really easy to make also. If you're interested, if you're like a DIYer, there's like a zillion YouTube tutorials on how to do it. It's dirt cheap. And when you're done with them, they can be composted. So you would use that anywhere that you would use plastic wrap. The for cloth, that's really great for wrapping up greens. So if you have a head of lettuce, you can just wrap that up in a damp tea towel and just stick that right in the fridge, and it'll keep the lettuce like nice and crisp for like a week. It works really, really well. When you use it, how do you soften it? Oh, when you get a beeswax wrap, it is very, very stiff. And just after using it a few times, it'll become really soft and floppy. It just needs to be like broken, like a piece of tin foil.
Yeah, actually, I've tried using beeswax, but sometimes it doesn't cling as well, and it, opens up. So I probably need to look for a better quality one, or something, or make my own someday. Oh, just hold on to it with your hands. Okay, so let's see. Is it accurate that compost in a backyard bin needs to heat up a certain temperature internally before it's ready, or is it just a matter of time, something, water, etc.?
It depends on how serious you want to get about it. I do the extremely lazy method of just chucking stuff in the bin and turning it. I've never measured the heat of my compost. I just sort of go by how moist it looks and what it smells like. So if it looks too moist, then it needs more browns. If it looks too dry, then it probably needs more greens, or those would be your food scraps. I think I've added water to it maybe once or twice. I do it in a very lazy way. It depends on how fast you want it to turn over as well. If you're going for, oh, I need it in 3 weeks or whatever, then you can get into monitoring the internal temperature. Just make sure you're turning it at least once a week so that it doesn't get too hot, which can happen during summer months. But right now it's like 8 degrees outside, and when I put my hand above mine, I can feel that it's warm, which is neat. But I don't get all technical about it. I just let it do its thing.
Annette asks, do you ever barter any excess? Do you know of any bartering apps or sites?
Ooh, that's a good one. If you have a local buy nothing group, join your buy nothing group and you can offer it up. People will come and get it. If you have way too much compost, like people will come and get it. If you've got plants you want to get rid of, dig them up. People will come and get them. So you can put a call out in your local buy nothing group. That would be the best place to ask for what's local to you as well. Like, does anybody know about a group that does this or whatever? Those are going to be the folks that you're going to want to ask.
Ashlyn does have a buy nothing Facebook group, as is the town I live in.
Awesome.
Dan said something about 66% brown, 33% green for compost. And Linda asks, did you see Chopped last night? I love that show. I hate food network show. I hate food shows because I think of all the waste that they must have. But I kind of do kind of like them. Anyways, Linda says it was about cooking food that would be tossed. Where can we get more guidance on saving and cooking food scraps?
Okay, so again, I have to plug this book. So I'm obsessed with it. If you don't follow Zero Waste Chef, go follow her for sure. Her website is incredible for how to store food, how to reuse food. She's fantastic. Another cool person to follow is Max Lamana, and he's also a zero waste chef, and just really incredible resources on how to reuse food that you would think doesn't look good anymore, or what do I do with it, or I have these four random things in my fridge that I got to get rid of before I go grocery shopping. What can I do? Those are two really fantastic resources that I lean on a lot when I'm not sure what to do with things, or is this salvageable? Oh, I meant to mention this actually during the talk and completely slipped my mind regarding salvageable, is to know the difference between best before dates and expiry dates. Best before dates is about quality, like it'll taste the best, it'll have the best crispness or whatever, but it has nothing to do with the actual safety of the food. Whereas an expiry date has to do with whether or not it's edible. So you see expiry dates on like dairy, but the best before date on your chips, like it doesn't matter. It's fine. It's a shelf stable food. Just use your best judgment, but it's not necessarily expired. That's not what a best before date means.
Oh, that's good to know. I did want to say that we have a program next Thursday, next Wednesday, the 17th, April 17th. We have a with cookbook author Lindsay J. Hard, who wrote a book called Cooking with Scraps. And she's actually going to do a demonstration on how to make banana bread with banana peels.
You
So
can
if
eat them.
you
You can eat those.
I'm fascinated by this. But anyway, so everybody who's here, I'll definitely send out that link as well as some of the resources that
That's
Sarah's
cool.
mentioning today. Do you want to ask, what kind of a dehydrator are you using?
Mine's called an Excalibur. It's super intense. I just keep it in the basement on top of our deep freezer. It's a five shelf one. The shelves are about this big. And you can make anything in it. I can do fruit leather in it. I've done tomato paste in it. Like I said, I dry all my herbs, all of that kind of stuff. I do a lot of canning, especially tomatoes at the end of the summer. And so I'm left with like tons and tons of skins. And I dehydrate the skins and grind those into powder, and that works about as well as tomato paste when you're doing thickening, that sort of thing. So I use it a lot.
And Bethany wants to know if the zero waste chefs focus on mostly plant-based or diets or meats.
It's all plant-based.
Okay. All right. That's what I thought.
It's all plant-based. Which, I mean, you can make any vegetarian meal into a meat-based meal. You just add meat to it, add cheese to it, whatever. But I find the plant-based re recipes very versatile in that respect. So,
Okay. Kathy asks, broccoli turning yellow. I usually hate myself in compost. Would you use it?
when it's starting to turn yellow on the top, I would probably cut off the floret part. Like the part that looks like the leaf of the tree, but broccoli stems are edible, and the broccoli stems are still going to be fine. So you can cut off the weird bits, and then just submerge the actual stalk in water for in cold water for a couple hours. That'll firm it back up, and then you can cut and eat the stem. So you can still salvage part of it even when the florets are starting to turn.
Okay, great. Dan asks, and I think we talked about this a little bit before, but maybe we can dig into a little bit more about how do you use the powders that you make?
So I'll use them in soups, in smoothies, in sauces, just depending on what it is. Like, oh, a little bit of this and a little bit of that. I just pretend I'm in potions class. And then that way I'm just sort of beefing up, so to speak, whatever it is that I'm making. I do that with when the kale starts going crazy in the garden, I'll make kale powder, just throw it in whatever you're cooking, just like a teaspoon here, a tablespoon there. It gets used. But again, if that's not something you're interested in, it's fine. Just compost it. Making soil is cool too.
And is drying, dehydrating better than, or there's certain things that are better dehydrated versus frozen.
Yeah, so it really depends on what you're doing with it. So I will make apple chips rather than freeze apples or make apple fruit leather, that sort of thing. It really depends on what it is and what you're going to use it for.
Okay. All
Yeah,
right.
that's a tricky one.
Yeah, but there are lots of options. You said like you can dehydrate, we can freeze. And there was another one that you mentioned, but now I don't remember. And it says, I feel guilty making smoothies. It takes so much water to clean my machine. Is that silly? Should we do something else?
Like to clean out the barrel of the blender. I saw a trick on this on YouTube and it blew my mind. And basically, if you put like this much water in your blender when you're done and like a pump of dish soap and then blend that, it's clean. And then all you have to do is rinse it. It blew my mind. It was amazing. So try that.
Okay. Bethany also asks, is there a lazy sustainability guide or place to start out? I feel a guilty asking this, but I also know myself.
So you can start with my blog.
I would. She's
so
great.
yeah. But what I will say about like where to start is first think about what you're interested in. So if you're a fashion girly, then maybe start thrifting or looking into sustainable brands or whatever. If you really enjoy cooking, then looking into these different ways of storing your food, get some produce bags, whatever it is. Think about what it is that you are interested in and what you're good at, and go from there. You can't do everything. I can't do everything. Like I know about all this stuff, and I can't. Like we're just not set up for it. I'm busy. You're busy. We have lives. We're just trying to do the thing, right? So, whatever you're interested in, lean into that. All roads lead to the same place. Everything is connected. But whatever it is that if you're interested in art, look at if there's any creative reuse areas. Look at swapping with folks on buy nothing or whatever it is. If you're, into graphic design or whatever, like can you help your local library to promote programs like this? Whatever it is that you're interested in, there is an eco thing that you can do that's associated with that. That's the place to start because you're going to be passionate about that.
And actually, that brings me to this next question, which I think you and I talked about maybe in our first session, because you had said that you used to make your own soaps and things like that, but like that would just had to go because it was just getting too much. So this question is, I was curious to know your suggestions for non-food items such as detergents, shower products, cleaning products, etc.
So I'm very lucky in that I have two refill stores that are local to me now, which I didn't when I first started to go like zero waste like 8 or 9 years ago. So like you said, I was making everything and I got really stuck on being perfect and being plastic free and all of that. And it was very time consuming and really like stressful, like which is stupid. like I'm not Exxon. Do you know what I mean? Like it's fine if I need to buy something in plastic. But I started refilling. So we have a company here. I'm not sure if they're in the States yet, but it's called Pure. And so I can refill anything that's soap related, I can refill through them. But there's so many great products on the market now, that are like little tablets that you can then just put in water, and that makes your hand soap and your dish soap and that sort of thing. I'm trying to think of the brand off the top of my head. Blue Planet, I think it's called. Something like that. There's laundry strips, things like that. You can use soap berries. But yeah, if you like making stuff, that's cool. Make it. There's lots of recipes out there. And if you don't, and you don't have a refill store, look into the soap tabs. They're really cool. I use those for all of our foaming hand soaps now. And they work really well.
And do you just get those at the regular store, or are you ordering them online? I know you don't order a lot of stuff online.
So like I said, I'm lucky that I have the two refill stores near me now. But if you do want to order online, look for an eco shop like Tiny Yellow Bungalow or Zero Waste Movement, something that's not Amazon. But again, if that's what you have access to, like that's fine. We're going for good, not perfect. So yeah, definitely look into the soap tabs because they're very cool. They take up such little space compared to a whole jug of soap. Liquid soap is mostly water. They're selling us water. So if you can get the concentrate, like you're golden. Your dish soap might not be as viscous as you're used to, but it's working just as well, I promise.
I know we have a problem with well, the dryer sheets, because those are really bad for the environment, I've been told. So do you make your own the dryer balls? Do you make those?
I purchased some the wool dryer balls. I think I got three for like $12 at Home Goods, or I think it's called Home Goods in the States. It's called something different here, but I just got them there. They're pure wool, three dryer balls. I've had them. They look like they've been through it. Because I've used them for 10 years now. You can put a drop of essential oil on them. They work great. Yeah, there's no need for a dryer sheet. They're plastic. Dryer sheets are plastic.
Yeah, we actually made them in our do-it-yourself green products program last year. It was really fun, and people came up to me afterwards and said, "I'm still using those dryer balls." So they're reusable. It's great. So Kathy says, "I just check composted a bag of yucky spinach in the original plastic bag. Great idea that needs to breathe. Never thought of that. That I worry that even refills originally came in something. Not sure really reduces plastic."
So everything has to come in something, right? Like even at the bulk store, they are, yes, pouring a huge bag into a container. What we're doing is reducing the amount of packaging. So instead of 20 small bottles of dish soap, it's one jug. And I work with one of the refill stores here in town, and a lot of these companies are sustainable companies as well. So they have what's called a closed loop system. So they deliver it in a great big, whatever a gallon is. So it's a big 40-liter jug. It's a big 40-liter jug, and when that's empty, that jug goes back to that company who will wash it and refill it and send it back out. So everything's got to come in something, but most of these companies also have closed loop systems in place as well, so that they're not spending money on packaging that just gets thrown away as well. So not perfect, but much better.
Yeah, I heard that Poland Spring started doing that with their big water jugs, the ones that go into like office coolers and things, not the small water bottles, unfortunately. But I thought that
Well,
was, I was like, of course, of course you should do that. Linda asks, do you only use cold water for laundry?
Yes.
Yes.
Only.
You find that no problems with that. Okay. Good. So I'm getting some suggestions for refill stores. I th think there's one in Ashland, but only for maybe only for tea and coffee. If somebody remind me if I'm wrong about that. But we're getting there. We're slowly getting there. So when you're like buying, how do you make sure that you're only buying, you know, you have the lists and things like that. That's where where you were saying, like, don't say no. Is that where you're saying, don't just say no to something?
So for example, a lot of things that are sold to us now are for convenience, right? So the example that I always give is like the little yogurt cups that we put in our kids' lunches. And it'll come in a package of like eight little yogurt cups. They're just not being recycled. They're just not. Only 9% of plastic is recycled worldwide. So instead of buying the little eight single cups, get the big tub and just portion it out into a reusable container. So that's when I'm like, no, I'm going to refuse this convenience item that's actually wildly inconvenient. You still have to deal with all these stupid little cups all the time in your house and wash them out and recycle them and the whole thing. Whereas if you're just using one larger container, now you've only got one container that you can find a reuse for, or what have you. So when I say refuse, it's like stop buying stuff you don't need, and really rethink these convenience items that you don't need individual packages of crackers when you could just buy a big box of crackers, right? Like there's really no purpose to it, and it actually isn't that convenient. It takes up more space in your house, it's more trash, it's more expensive. and so on.
That's true. So let me go into school lunches. There is a huge waste in schools around lunches. How I know you've talked about, sending packaged foods with your kids, but some of those even get wasted. The food, if the kids don't eat it. What can we do to get our schools to be more sustainable around this?
Around school lunches.
Yes.
So there's our school does we they've tried a couple of things over the years. At one point, one parent had put green bins in all of the classrooms and would just deal with them herself. And then her kids graduated. So now what our school does is what's called a litterless lunch. Or it's called a boomerang lunch in some places. So containers are encouraged, and whatever comes to a school must go back home. The kids are not allowed to throw things out at lunch. So not only are they're not dealing with the food waste, but it comes back to your home so you can see what your kid actually ate or didn't eat. And then you can adjust based on that. Like, okay, they are just not eating the apple slices. I'm going to stop sending those because they just end up in the compost bin at the end of every day. That sort of thing. So if you are on your school council, you could even do this at the classroom level with your classroom teacher, is try to institute this boomerang lunch policy where it's not about making all the parents send things package free. It's just about it turning around and coming back home. And then you can see what your kid's eating, making sure that they're eating enough. And also you can adjust to see how much is being wasted. Can this go back into their lunch tomorrow? Can this go back into the cupboard? Can this go into a smoothie for breakfast? That kind of thing, rather than it all just ending up in the trash at the school.
I think our problem more is the kids that buy lunch, and then obviously the parents have no idea. And I think there are a lot of places now that have free lunch for everybody. So then the kids, have there's no skin in the game to, not waste it. So they'll take, I mean, how do you teach your kids to just not waste?
That is a daily battle in this house as well. And my kids have me as their mom, and I'm still like, well, you're wasting all this cereal. You poured a whole bowl. You're not going to, that one's really tricky because they're not the ones paying for it, but my kids have to scrape their own plates, rinse their own dishes. They have to take the compost bin out. They have to turn it. And so when they can start to see the life cycle of food, then they start to appreciate it more. So that starts with knowing that food doesn't come from the grocery store, like taking them to farms to see how food grows, or getting in the garden or what have you. They prepare food with you, they clean up the kitchen with you, they deal with the compost with you. Otherwise, it just doesn't exist. It's, and that's fair. They don't have to deal with any of the other parts, so it just doesn't even occur to them.
Dan says some products are listed as commercially biodegradable, compostable. Do these require more heat and pressure to make, or are they actually true? Because I don't know.
No.
I'm cynical about it.
So, yeah, same. These like compostable, or if it says compostable and recyclable,
Oh no,
when you
it
see
says
these like
biodegradable.
even biodegradable and compostable mean two different things. So biodegradable means that it would naturally just break down in the environment. So think about just tossing an apple into your backyard. That would naturally break down in the environment. Compost does require heat and water. So like we talked about the backyard compost getting warm, that helps things break down faster. What these products require is industrial composting. So these like the compostable fork or whatever, or takeout container is not going to break down in your backyard compost, probably because it's just not hot enough. That requires an industrial composting situation. And we have that here in my municipality in our green bin, and certain things are still not accepted because that particular facility can't handle them. So it's biodegradable. It means for like actual plant material that will decay in nature. Like if you chucked that compost container or that takeout container out in your backyard, it's not going to break down. You know that. So that means that it requires an industrial process, and an industrial process is where facilities exist.
I don't think we have that.
So,
Is
It's
your
one of
child?
those things where like it's better than plastic because like black plastic is not recyclable, for example. But we don't need a better coffee cup. We need reusable systems.
I have to say that Sarah taught me that at our first session as well. Now I never throw away like plastic bags at like when we get cheese or whatever at the grocery store at the deli. We keep those and we use them for packaging up things in the refrigerator, or I know not plastic, but like we just keep using it over and over instead of throwing it away.
It's only single use if you use it once. So
Very true. And Marianne asked, it's not a food question, but is there a bamboo toilet paper you like?
oh, okay. I'm like, woo. So I actually use Staples. Do you have Staples? Yeah, of course you do. The Staples office supply. So it's not bamboo, but it is 100% post-consumer recycled paper. You have to order it online. I think it's made by Cascades now, and you get 48 rolls in a box. So I order 2 boxes twice a year, and it all comes. There's no plastic at all, and it's 100% post-consumer recycled paper. I think Who Gives a Crap, it's called, is a bamboo toilet paper. I've tried it and I like it. It's expensive because to get it shipped to Canada is expensive, but they sent me a box and I tried it. I will say that their rolls are the best toilet paper rolls for reusing. Because I use toilet paper rolls for all kinds of things. So the Who Gives a Crap rolls are amazing.
Are
And
those
then
the ones that
real,
come, I'm sorry, are those the ones that come in the black and white
like
packaging?
the fancy paper. Yeah, and then
Okay, all
you
right.
can use the paper as tissue paper, like in gift bags and things like that. Yeah, they do a really good job. We don't have it here. And then reel paper is another one. Reel, like Instagram reels, REEL, is another one that's pretty decent.
So just about out of time. Do you have any last suggestions or thoughts or things that you want us to leave with?
Be imperfect. I really can't stress that enough. Like, if you have to throw some food in the trash, like, it's fine. Again, you're not big oil. You're not, a billionaire. Like, you're fine. You're doing the best that you can. And that absolutely is good enough.
Wonderful. Hetty asks, and we're not going to answer this question, Hetty. What do you use toilet paper roll for? Because we're going to put, maybe ask Sarah back to just do a craft show with us. Not
I just
craft,
put up a reel
craft.
about it. I just put up a reel about it. Hey, you can check it out. I have 7 suggestions in there for you.
There you go. Follow her on Instagram. She's amazing. Okay, Sarah, thank you so much again for
Thank you.
this. And we will see you, I think, in October. For a holiday,
Somewhere
something.
in there.
Yeah, sustainable holidays. So we really look forward to that. But as always, we've learned so much and from each other too. People have had some great ideas here. So,
The chat was awesome. Thanks, guys.
that's right. We're very smart people here. So, anyways, have a wonderful night. Thank you, Sarah. We'll see you
You
soon.
too.
All right. Good night,
Thank you so
everybody.
much. Bye.
Bye.